Well, an opportunity for Brian Robson now to deliver his verdict on today's Man of the Match, Brian.
Well, I feel Martin Keown, he's had a good week. He did well in the England game, and I think he hasn't put a foot wrong today. So I'm going for Martin Keown.
So the Everton defender caps a fine week for him with an award from a man whose opinion I'm sure he'll greatly respect. Not very often you get an own goal and a Man of the Match award, is it? But he couldn't do much about that. Just been announced on the public address system here. I'm sure Brian Robson wasn't being diplomatic, but the Evertonians love that. Here's Strachan. Cantona flicking it on. Ward breaks clear for Everton. Less than 2 minutes remaining. It's one each. Jackson. That's a good ball. Beardsley takes it. McAllister covering well though. Turned it back towards Mo Johnston, and Sterling had to clear his lines instantly. Beardsley again. Everill. He hit it well, but it was always well wide too. Great Evertonians of old in a line: Jimmy Gabriel, Howard Kendall, Colin Harvey, played in different championship sides, all of them down the years. Sitting just behind, there's another great ex-Evertonian, Alex Young, in the stand today. It's tomorrow though that these Everton supporters are looking to, not yesterday, for glories. They haven't won the league since 1986. A lot of money on players, Everton. They don't want to see their side midway down the table. Here's Dorigo for Leeds United, whose own ambitions are centred on the league championship. That's a good looking cross. Cantona far post, too many defenders ahead of him, and Keown concedes the throw. And it goes towards White, and then towards Fairclough. Back out to McAllister. Sterling. And he overhit that goal kick. And we are now into stoppage time. And it looks as though Leeds United will have to settle for 1 point, which would reduce the gap between them and Manchester United to 3. Remember, Manchester United at home to Chelsea on Wednesday night. Don't have a midweek fixture. Offside. Not offside this time. Peter Beardsley. Though, back in it goes towards McAllister. Everton win it back with Beegree now. That's the final whistle, and it has ended in a draw. Leeds United taking the lead when Carl Schupp forced Martin Keown into the error, which produced an own goal. And then a few minutes later, Everton equalising with the first ever goal in senior football for their 20-year-old right-back, Matthew Jackson. In the end, I think a draw, probably a just result over the balance of play. It won't really do a great deal of help for Everton in their mid-table position. And, well, I suppose 1 point is better than none at all as far as Leeds United are concerned. We find out exactly what their manager, Howard Wilkinson, thinks of it. He's with Gary Newbon.
Howard, most away teams settle for a point, but do you look at that as 2 points lost for the championship position as it is?
No, there's a lot of football left in the championship, yes. It's a good result. In view of how we played, it was a good result. Because we only played well enough to get a draw. We didn't play well enough to win the match today.
Why was that?
I don't know. Simple things. Didn't get the ball wide enough, early enough, didn't get enough crosses in. Pitch was too big when we lost it. Too many short balls in the middle of the park, getting cut out. No, not one of our best performances, and a draw is a good result.
And your strike force, Cantona, found it very difficult in his first game in England.
He's finding it very difficult. Welcome to the English Football League for Eric.
Do you think he'll make it?
He's got to. If he doesn't, he sinks.
What about Lee Chapman? I know you'd prefer to have him on the pitch than on our commentary position. When can you get him back?
I don't know. It depends how much you're paying him.
We won't be paying him as much as you, I can promise you that.
He's going to stay up there forever.
But obviously you need him back, don't you?
Well, you can't afford to be without good players for too long. I mean, he's a good player.
How does this leave the league position for you? Because you're a game behind and 3 points behind. They've got a game in hand with 3 points behind.
Oh, still miles of football left in it. Still miles of football.
Okay. Thank you, Howard.
Well, a very honest appraisal there by Howard Wilkinson with a touch of humour as well. So Manchester United now 3 points ahead of Leeds in the First Division Championship race. The views of their captain, Brian Robson, right after this break. Welcome back. Everton 1, Leeds 1. Brian, you were hoping for an Everton win at the start of it. From Manchester United's point of view, settle for the point?
Yeah, we've got to be quite pleased that Leeds have dropped 2 points, especially going in front. They'll be disappointed as well, conceding the goal the way they conceded it. You don't like to give goals away at set pieces, and Leeds are brilliant at that. And, you know, they've conceded from a thing that they're very good at when they're attacking.
Unusual as well that to concede a lead in such an important game as well. The first goal, which was a sort of tragedy for your man of the match, Martin Keown, although there's not much he could do about it.
That's right. The ball's looped up in the air when the shot's blocked there. Neville will be disappointed about that. He's came and he hasn't really got a good connection. He's swung in it and Martin's been very unlucky that the ball's went in off his shin, you know, into the goals.
The thing about Martin Keown, which we saw in the international at Wembley on Wednesday as well, he's always attacking the ball, so, I mean, it's inevitable that things like that are going to happen.
Yes, that's right. He just couldn't quite get his leg there quick enough and unfortunately for him, it's gone into the net.
Now, as you say, as far as the goal that Leeds can conceded, and I suppose if any team should be able to defend against the near post corner routine, it's the team that practice it more than any other.
They'll be definitely disappointed about that. I mean, they've got a lot of bodies in at the near post, and there's nobody picking up on the far post. It's a classic goal that Leeds score all the time, so like we say, you know, they're going to be disappointed conceding that one.
Nice little flick on by Gary Ablett. I think we thought it was Martin Keown at the time. Right, as far as Leeds are concerned, did you see anything that frightened you today?
Yeah, they're frightened us because they're still close to us. No, Leeds are a strong side. When Lee Chapman gets back in as well, they'll be even stronger again. But they've got good players and they'll give us a run for our money.
All right, Brian, thanks very much indeed. Let's move on now to our goal of the day competition, starting with Brian, Manchester United's 2-0 win over Crystal Palace. Manchester United ended a sequence of low-scoring draws against a lively-looking Palace who were very difficult to break down away from home. Ryan Giggs' cross was too quick for Hughes to make a sure-footed connection, more like hit and hope, but it paid off. As ever, Brian McClair was involved as United worked hard to create openings, something they've struggled to do since the turn of the year. A rare run-of-the-mill goal by Hughes and the first time United have scored more than one goal in a league game since Boxing Day. Well, near the end, Hughes and Eric Young, Welsh international colleagues, of course, got involved in a bit of pushing and shoving. Hughes was booked, which means a two-match ban, including the Rumbelows League Cup semi-final second leg against Middlesbrough. City's hopes of qualifying for Europe are decreasing because of their increasingly poor away form. Alan Cork's cross for John Fashanu, but where on earth were Keith Curl and co? Peter Reid's priority is a tall, ball-winning centre-half, and you can appreciate why. Virtually unopposed, Fashanu headed down for Robbie Earle to make it two. But there really are signs that the crazy gang spirit is returning under Wimbledon's new manager, Joe Kinnear. For City, things improved in the second half following young Mike Sherren's introduction. Steve McMahon bided his time before setting up Sherren for City's goal, but it's a defeat that leaves them 10 points off the pace in third position. After their 7-1 mauling by Arsenal, Sheffield Wednesday's character was very much under the microscope against West Ham, who went in front after Slater's shot was parried by Chris Woods and Mike Small did a sort of dancing round the maypole routine. You don't see too many goals like that. Into the last 10 minutes and Wednesday proved they've still got what it takes. Carlton Palmer got an equaliser and with 3 minutes left, West Ham's mini-revival was interrupted when Viv Anderson headed in a free kick. If it's any consolation for last week's embarrassment, Wednesday now have the best home scoring record in the First Division, along with Arsenal. Liverpool's injury problems going from bad to worse, a bit like their defending at Carrow Road. The invisible man would have been more conspicuous than Colin Woodthorpe, standing by Grobbelaar's near post and scoring at the second attempt. Well, any lingering hopes Liverpool may have had about winning the championship disappeared in a disastrous 20-minute spell. Mark Wright, who's been outstanding in recent weeks for club and country, caught in two minds and subsequently caught out by Robert Flegg. Next to slip up, Glenn Hussein. But all in all, Liverpool's back division not on the same wavelength as Flegg, who grabbed his opportunities brilliantly. This is class finishing. Goal of the day, contender A. Spurs, with the worst home record in the First Division, went in front in this North London derby when Paul Stewart got on the end of Naeem's cross. But just when it appeared they would win at home for only the fifth time this season, Arsenal benefited from a rare mistake by Gary Mabbutt. The game was into injury time when Ian Wright stretched Arsenal's unbeaten run to five games. Forest fans won't have seen many better individual goals than this, apart from Stuart Pearce free kicks, of course. Teddy Sheringham, goal of the day contender B, and the quickest goal of the day after 40 seconds. Mind you, Forest fans haven't seen their team win at home in the league since early December, and they haven't won at all in the league since Boxing Day. Scott Gemmell off the line. Forest totally vacated that area of the goalmouth after that, and just guess who popped into the empty space? Clive Allen. Earl Barrett, Villa's new £1.75 million signing from Oldham, watched his old club play with the confidence of a team who'd won their previous two, but they were unusually shy in front of goal. As for Villa, with Matthias Breitkreutz making his debut, their first in the league since New Year's Day proved decisive. Froggitt's cross, a vintage header by Regis, contender C. Queen's Park Rangers are the First Division's draw specialists, 5 in the last 6 and 14 overall. The passing game is always good to watch. Ray Wilkins playing in the killer ball for Les Ferdinand, making his first appearance since getting injured in November. Goalkeeper Steve Cherry partly responsible for Notts County's goal. His long kick eventually got through to Steve Slawson, making his debut and displaying admirable poise and awareness, creating the space for Kevin Bartlett to get the equaliser. A dirty word at Loftus Road. Here's a goal kick that went wrong. Sheffield United Simon Tracy seeing his kick headed straight back into the path of Brian Steen. Tracy had one eye on Steen, Steen had one eye on Tracy. The ball broke kindly for Luton, and Steen scored his first goal for the club since the 1988 League Cup final against Arsenal. Sheffield United, who won their previous four league games, equalised 4 minutes later when Luton failed to clear an awkward up and under. Ian Bryson. But Luton's young team play some neat football, and their winner was well worked and a deserved goal of the day contender. Scott Oakes put in a penetrating cross which bounced and set up nicely for Mick Harford, the club's top scorer. Well, they should have won more comfortably, but credit to Tracy, who'd obviously done his homework and sussed out John Dreyer's penalty technique. A big ovation at the Dell for England's new hero, Alan Shearer. But Southampton's inability to perform in the league the way they do in cup ties is looking more and more likely to end up in relegation. Ian Dowie's header, the closest they came to a goal.
Turinga, as always, is 0898, 1-0, 1-0, 1-0. I can remember that without even looking at it. Right, what have we got coming up on the match? Well, we've got two dates next week, starting on Sunday with the second leg of the Rumbelows League Cup semi-final between Spurs and Nottingham Forest. It's poised at 1-1. And then on Wednesday, we're off to Holland, again to see Spurs, this time away to Feyenoord in the European Cup Winners' Cup quarter-final first leg. So live from the Feyenoord Stadium next Wednesday night, a stadium which holds a special place in your memory.
That's right, happy memories.
Winning there against Barcelona, winning the final there last year. It's a stadium that does generate a great atmosphere and one that could be intimidating for Tottenham if things don't go too well.
It could be, but it's a nice big pitch and I think that'll suit Tottenham. You know, they'll get there and they'll get a lot of people behind the ball and try and hit the Feyenoord on the break. And I think it'll suit Tottenham.
Now, of course, you're one of the other semi-finalists in the Rumbelows League Cup, and if you get through against Middlesbrough, do you think you'll be playing either Spurs or Forest at Wembley?
I've got a feeling for Forest. It's a difficult one because Tottenham always seem to do well when they go to Nottingham, and yet Nottingham do well when they go down to Tottenham. It's 1-1 at the moment, but I just feel that Forest might just edge that game.
And of course, Spurs do have an awful home record at the moment. Brian, thanks for being with us this afternoon. Not a bad day for you. From all of us on the match, very good afternoon to you.